In the last lecture, we had seen how the method of scalar potential can be used to find out the magnetization and the magnetic field due to a uniformly magnetized sphere. What we will do today is continue in the same line and try to solve the same problem, namely when we have a uniformly magnetized sphere, what is the corresponding field B and the field H due to it, but this time we will be using the method of vector potential. Of course, both of them being equally good in this case will lead to the same result, and first we will do that. After that, in the second half of this lecture, we will be introducing, till now we have been talking about static phenomena. We started with electrostatics and then we went to magnetostatics. We will be for the first half we will still be with magnetostatics, but in the later half we will bring in some time varying phenomena and introduce some other aspects of the electromagnetic theory. So, let me begin by reminding you that we had seen that if I have magnetization M, the corresponding magnetic vector potential due to it A was given by mu 0 by 4 pi. Well, basically M divided by R cube. Now, what we did is to say that if I have a magnetization distribution, then this is actually M cross R divided by R cube. Now, if I have a distribution of magnetization, then we were able to write it in two parts. One was a surface integral part and another was a volume integral part, like here. And we had seen that the vector potential A can be written as a surface integral of n cross m by r minus r prime cube. So, that tells me that there is an equivalent surface, magnetizing surface current, if you like, which is equal to minus n cross m. Remember, inside the integral all my quantities have primes. Now, and there is a volume density which is given by del cross m. But in this case, I have got a uniform magnetization. So, as a result, my del cross m term is 0. So, I need to simply concentrate on the term which is surface integral term, which is written as A of r equal to minus mu 0 by 4 pi integral over the surface of n prime cross m of r prime over r minus r prime and ds. Now, this is the quantity that we will like to calculate, and this n cross m or with a minus sign, that is my equivalent surface current due to magnetization. So, J s of r, in this case r prime, is given by minus n prime cross m of r prime. And what we will do is, if you refer back to this picture, we will take the direction of the magnetization as the z axis, so that the angle between the direction of magnetization and the radial vector will be taken as theta. So, therefore, this quantity is nothing but m sin theta, and the direction of that is clearly the azimuthal direction E phi. This is a direction on the surface of the sphere, which is perpendicular to both the radial direction and the z direction. Now, if you look at how the phi is defined, I will just recall for you, I am not drawing a three dimensional picture, but I am drawing a two dimensional picture. Remember that the radial vector is along the radial direction is the r vector, and what I do is to drop a perpendicular onto the x y plane, and it is the foot of the perpendicular which is, so this p is the foot of the perpendicular from the tip of the radius vector, and this angle which you make with the x-axis, that's my azimuthal angle phi. Now, we had seen earlier that whenever we define a unit vector, it is defined in the direction of the increasing quantity. So, in this case, obviously, my unit vector will be like this. So, this will be my unit vector which I wrote as E phi. So, as a result, this E phi can be resolved into a component along the x direction, which is minus. So, this angle is being phi, this angle is phi. So, this is 90 minus phi, and a component along the y direction. So, therefore, let us write down E of phi to be equal to m sin, E of phi is minus sin phi. Well, I am using phi prime. So, minus sin phi prime unit vector I minus, because that is that direction, plus cos phi prime unit vector j. So, this is my E phi, and we had seen that j s of r prime, which is what I am going to write down, is given by m sin theta prime times this quantity E phi there, which is minus sin phi prime I plus cos phi prime j. And I need to now calculate the integral which is involved in the expression for the A of r. So, let us go back to A of r. So, A of r is given by mu 0 by 4 pi. I have taken care of the minus sign which is outside, and this will be equal to m sin theta prime into minus sin phi prime I plus cos phi prime j divided by r minus r prime and ds, of course. Okay. So, the question is, how do I evaluate this integral? Now, what I will do is, I will calculate the part which is along the y direction. And the reason is, as I go along, I will make a comment which will show that this term can be shown to be equal to 0, and we will see why. But at the moment, I will be just evaluating this term with a cos phi prime j. Now, notice that in doing so, what I do is to use the property of the spherical harmonics, the orthogonal property of spherical harmonics. So, we know that 1 over r minus r prime can be expanded in spherical harmonics. So, what I will do is this, that since I told you that I am going to do only the y component. So, we have in y component in the numerator, we have a quantity which is sin theta prime cos phi prime. Our idea is to express this quantity as in terms of spherical harmonics. Now, you can check that from the spherical harmonics table, that I can write y 1 1 theta phi, well, in this case theta prime phi prime, it does not matter, is equal to minus square root of 3 by 8 pi sin theta prime e to the power I phi prime. And y 1 minus 1 theta prime phi prime is plus square root of 3 by 8 pi sin theta prime e to the power minus I phi prime. So, what I do is this, I can use the definition of sine and cosine, that well, sine is of course already there, and cosine I know is e to the power I phi plus e to the power minus I phi by 2. So, therefore, sine theta prime cos phi prime can be written as square root of 2 pi by 3, there is a root 3 by 8 pi, but I need also a factor of 2 in my definition of cos phi and sin phi. this times it turns out to be y 1 1 theta prime phi prime minus, well actually there is overall minus sign also, minus y 1 minus 1 theta prime phi prime. Well, sin theta prime cos theta phi prime is this, sin theta prime sin phi prime which is there, which is I am writing it down so that you can see why that term turns out to be 0. So, sin theta prime sin phi prime, you can easily show that it is given by root 2 pi by 3, there is an I there because sin is defined as e to the power I phi minus e to the power minus I phi by 2i. So, this into this is y 1 1 theta prime phi prime plus y 1 minus 1 theta prime phi prime. So, basic idea is this, that I am going to express 1 over r minus r prime in terms of spherical harmonics, recognize the fact that in the numerator also I have spherical harmonics. So, as a result, what I am going to do is to write down the entire thing in terms of spherical harmonics. I recall that 1 over r minus r prime can be written as 4 pi sum over L sum over m 1 over 2 L plus 1, this is something which we did last time also, r lesser raised to the power L by r greater raised to the power L plus 1 y L m star theta prime phi prime, which are the angles corresponding to the vector r prime, into y L m theta phi, which are the angles corresponding to the vector r. Now, what we do is this, I define my point of observation as in the x z plane. See, remember that I can always do that because the only direction which is given to me is the z direction along which the magnetization direction is there. So, I have the liberty of choosing the x y plane. So, therefore, I choose my observation point to be in the x z plane, which means I choose phi to be equal to 0. This is an important point which simplifies the problem substantially. Okay. With that, A, remember I told you that the x component will go away, which I will make a comment on later, but let me say what is A y, which comes from sin theta cos phi prime part. So, I had this mu 0 over 4 pi, I have root up 2 pi by 3 m, r square came out of r square d omega, which is the angle integration, 4 pi from here, and then I have an integral to be performed, integral over L m 1 over 2 L plus 1, this is a rather long expression, but turns out to be reasonably easy, r lesser raised to the power L, r greater raised to the power L plus 1, then I have actual integration will be over. Well, you could recall I had shown this to be equal to y 1 minus 1 minus y 1 1, I had taken care of this minus sign by interchanging the y's. Then I have the two y L m's which came here, y L m star theta prime phi prime, y L m theta and 0, and of course, d omega prime. Remember that these also have theta prime phi prime as their arguments, y, because it came from sin theta prime cos phi prime. So, if you use the orthogonality condition of this, then integral, say for example, when you integrate this one with that one, then it tells you that L must be equal to 1 and m must be equal to minus 1, and similarly in this case L is equal to 1 and m is equal to 1. So, I get two terms And so what I am left with will be something like this. I have of course m r square. Root 2 pi by 3 I will retain because this term here. So, I have got still root 2 pi by 3. Four pi has cancelled out with that. So, I have a mu 0. Since L is equal to 1, I get 2L plus 1 which is equal to 3. Then of course, I have r lesser raised to the power L and L is equal to 1. So, therefore, it is simply r lesser by r greater to the power L plus 1 which means r square times this time it is y 1 minus 1 of theta, not theta prime, 0 minus y 1 1 and theta 0. Now, remember y both y 1 1 or y 1 minus 1, they had e to the power I phi and e to the power minus I phi respectively, but since phi is equal to 0, each one of them turns out to be a sin theta, but y 1 1 had a minus sign in front of it. So, therefore, this quantity turns out to be 2 sin theta. So, this along with this factor of 2 pi by 3. This turns out to be 2 sin theta. Well, at this stage I will also point out why the x component would vanish. In the x component I will have a very similar integral, but I will have y 1 minus 1 plus y 1 1, and so that would be sin theta minus sin theta which will be equal to 0. So, other than that this is essentially identical. So, let me then with that write down what I get for my a y. So, a y, so vector potential only has y component which is equal to m r square mu 0 by 3, well actually 2 mu 0 by 3 sin theta and r lesser divided by r greater whole square. So, this is the expression for the y component of the vector potential. And so, what I now do is that if I am inside the sphere, I know r greater than is capital R. So, the potential inside, so I get a r square which will cancel with this r square there. So, I will be left with m r square, sorry, I will be left with m 2 mu 0 by 3 and r sin theta. So, this is what I would have inside the sphere, and outside the sphere I will get a y again is given by m, outside this is r lesser is r. So, I get a m r cube then 2 mu 0 by 3 and r greater is small r. So, therefore, I get sin theta over r square. Now, if you remember that since phi is equal to 0, my r sin theta is nothing but my x. So, it is m 2 mu 0 inside only by 3 x. I am not doing this, but it because it has slightly more complicated, but you could do it as an exercise. Now, so therefore, inside the sphere my vector potential has only y component and it is proportional, the y component of the vector potential is proportional to x. If you recall, we had shown earlier that if y component of the vector potential is linear in x, it means a constant magnetic field. So, I can immediately evaluate the magnetic field inside and obviously it will only have z component, because b z will be then d a y by d x. Minus d a y d a x by d y, which is equal to 0. And since the vector potential is proportional to x, this simply gives me m times 2 mu 0 by 3. Now, this is identical to the expression that we had obtained using the scalar potential method. Of course, it has to, because it is the same thing. Before we conclude the subject of magnetostatics, let us do something else. Let me put this magnetized sphere in an external magnetic field of strength B 0. Now, since the equations are linear, I can simply add. So, we had in the absence of the external field. So, I am doing magnetized sphere in an external field. So, in the absence of the external field, I had this as 2 by 3 mu 0 m, m is the magnetization, and if I have an external field, I of course add b 0 to it. Now, I will define, I will get the corresponding value of h in terms of 1 over mu 0. So, I have got b 0 plus 2 by 3, which is simply the value of B minus M. This is simply 1 over mu 0 B minus M, this expression. And if you simplify it, it turns out to be simply equal to 1/3 of M. So, this is what I would get if I put it in an external field. Now, couple of comments. That suppose this material of the material of the sphere happens to be paramagnetic. Now, we had said that the just as in the absence of a magnetic material, my relationship between H and B is B by mu is H. Now, if I have a paramagnetic material, then my B is related to H through mu H. So, this is for paramagnetic. Where mu is the permittivity of the material. So, let us see what does it actually mean. So, this means in that case, what I will get is this B, which is 2 by 3 mu 0 m plus B 0. Will be equal to mu times B 0 by mu 0 minus 1/3 m. This is what it would be. Now, you can solve this equation and you get that magnetization m is written as 3 by mu 0 mu minus mu 0 by mu plus 2 mu 0 times B 0, and corresponding value of the magnetic field B will be 3 mu by mu plus 2 mu 0 times B 0. I urge you to look up the expression that we had derived when we had put a polarized, electrically polarized material into an electric field. And you will find that there is almost a direct similarity between these two expressions. The last comment that we want to make is that what happens if I have what are known as ferromagnetic substances. So, we had seen that in case of paramagnet, we have a relationship where B and H are parallel. If you reduce the external field to 0, the B field also goes away. Now, there are materials which are known as ferromagnets, and this is a picture of what happens in case of a ferromagnet. So, as I apply external field, the initially B rises, but for a certain strength of the external field, the value of B saturates. Now, the reason is that the ferromagnetism appears due to magnetic moments being aligned. Now, once in a particular material, all the magnetic moments have been aligned, I have nothing more to align it. And that then is the limit. After this, if you increase the magnetic field, nothing will happen because saturation has been reached. Supposing you saturate a ferromagnet by applying a magnetic field, and then you start reducing the strength of the magnetic field. Now, something interesting happens. Unlike in the case of a paramagnet, as you reduce the external field, the magnetization or the B direction does not retrace its own path. In fact, it picks up a different path. And when it picks up a different path, it will still have some memory, even after you have reduced the external field to be equal to 0, the magnetization is not lost. So, this is what is known as retentivity or the process of hysteresis. The material in some sense remembers having been subjected to a magnetic field in the past. So, you prepare a magnet by applying a magnetic field, then gradually bring the strength of the magnetic field to 0, you will find the magnetization will still exist as is shown here. In fact, you will need a magnetic field to be applied in the negative direction if you want the magnetism to vanish. And this is actually, this value is called the coercive field. And of course, there is then a symmetry of this. This loop is known as a hysteresis loop. Now, so therefore, we have now obtained two expressions. So, there is an expression which we derived, namely B, the total magnetic induction field is B 0 external field plus 2 by 3 mu 0 m. But this expression, this curve gives me a dependence of B on H, which is some functional relationship. So, what I do is this. That when I have this, let me write this equation for H. You go back, you can find that H is written as B 0 by mu 0 minus 1/3 m, and if you solve these two equations together, by eliminating m, you can get this expression, which is B equal to 3 B 0 minus 2 mu 0 H. This tells me that the relationship between B and H is a straight line with the slope being equal to minus 2 mu if you are plotting it against mu 0 h. Now, so therefore, I have a relationship which is given by the hysteresis, and I have derived a relationship between B and H. So, what I can do is this, that once I have subjected the ferromagnet to saturation and reduced, then I find out where is the intersection of this with B versus H relationship. And this is that point P there, which will sort of tell me how much is the value of the magnetization at that point. So, this is the way one determines the magnetization for a ferromagnetic sample. That brings us to an end of the magnetostatics, and what I am going to do now is to switch over to the phenomena, time dependent phenomena. So, but before I do that, let me start with a few definitions. So, one of them which we have talked about in case of electric field, very similarly one can define magnetic flux. The magnetic flux will be defined as this B dot ds. Now, look at this situation here. I have a surface S 1, which is this oval shaped plate, and on the same rim of S 1, I can have a fisherman's net type of a surface as well. I call this S 1, I call this S 2. Now, since the direction of the surface is always defined as an outward normal, the normal to the surface S 1 is like this and the normal to the surface S 2 is like that. Now, if you now use the fact that del dot of B equal to 0, which means the surface integral of B, B dot ds is equal to 0, then you can easily show that as long as the boundary is fixed, it does not matter what surface you take to define flux. So, phi n of S 1 equal to phi n of S 2. The second point that I want to talk to you is what is known as electromotive force. Remember, or let me alert to you, that what I am going to talk about is not a force at all. It is called electromotive force because of historical reason. But let us see what happens. Supposing you have an electric circuit and the electric circuit connected to a battery, and in the external circuit you have a current. Now, you can assume something like a Ohm's law, so that you know that the current is nothing but the electric field divided by the resistance. So, what I know is the integral of E dot dl is not equal to 0, because there is a current in fact flowing. However, we have seen in electrostatics the integral of E dot dl must be equal to 0. So, how does one understand this apparent contradiction? So, one of the things that I would like you to realize is that integral E dot dl equal to 0, alternatively del cross of E equal to 0, was a consequence of the fact that I was talking about electrostatic fields which are conservative. Now, what happens in a circuit is that, for instance, let us say that the current is flowing because of a battery connected to the circuit. So, I have an external loop where I can calculate E dot dl going from, let us say, the positive terminal to the negative terminal, and I get some value. Now, when I complete the circuit through the battery provides the motive force by usually in the case of a battery converting chemical energy to electrical energy, and that is a non-conservative field. So, therefore, this will provide, let us say, an integral E prime dot dl, which inside the battery will exactly cancel the E dot dl that I have calculated on the outer circuit. So, therefore, my electromotive force is actually integral, if you like, inside the battery from terminal to terminal of integral E dot dl. However, this non-conservative field is 0 outside the battery. So, I can actually complete the loop and redefine my electromotive force through this relationship here. That is, electromotive force, which I use script E for it, is loop integral of E prime dot dl, where E prime is the electric field that the battery has produced. Now, as I said, we are talking about time dependent phenomena. Faraday has had enunciated a law from observation, and what he had said is that he found by a set of experiments that whenever there is either a relative motion between the source of magnetic field and a circuit, or if by some reason, even if there is no relative motion, the magnetic field is changing with time, In both the cases, it gives rise to an equivalent or gives rise to an EMF. And what Faraday had said is that the EMF is equal to the rate of change of magnetic flux through the circuit. There is another law which goes along with the Faraday's law, and that is why you will find when we write down the Faraday's law, there will be a minus sign that it electromotive force is equal to minus d phi by dt. This minus is not to be treated as an algebraic quantity, but it is a reminder of the fact that there is another law called the Lenz's law, which tells us that if this is connected to a circuit, conducting circuit, the direction of the current will be such that this current would generate magnetic field of its own, which will tend to oppose the cause which generated it. Namely, if the flux was increasing as a result of our action, the induced current will be in such a direction that the flux would tend to decrease as a result. So, let us first talk about couple of cases connected with this production of EMF. Now, if my circuit is moving, if there is motion in the circuit or relative motion, I find it easy to explain the Faraday's law. And the explanation comes by the Lorentz force that acts on the charged particle. Remember that if a circuit is moving, the circuit has charges. These charges themselves then are physically moving along with the circuit. Now, so therefore, when a magnetic field is applied on a circuit, the charges that exist inside the circuit are now subjected to a Lorentz force. And this Lorentz force can make the charges move. So, that would be a source of my electromotive force. Now, let us look at that situation here. Look at this circuit which I have indicated in orange pattern, and let us suppose that this is my DL, that is, this circuit will be moving like this. Now, when this happens, the circuit is, for example, instantaneously moving by an amount DL. So, the charges in that will be subjected to a force, suppose a charge Q in that will be subjected to a force equal to Q times V cross B. So, electromotive, the EMF, which is the integral of electric field dotted with dl, which is F by Q dotted with dl, which is simply V cross B dotted with dl. Now, remember that what we have is the charges are subjected to a transverse force. So, the velocity direction is shown like this. And supposing as a result, this portion of the circuit tends to stretch like this, then the idea is that this DL would sweep an area. This DL will sweep an area. And so, this expression here is integral of V cross B dot DL that came from the Lorentz force. I use the fact A dot B cross C is B dot C cross A, etcetera, and rewrite it as equal to integral B dot dl cross V. Now, so dl cross V, this is dl, this is V, is the rate at which the area changes, because dl times the distance along this would be the area. So, therefore, this quantity can be shown to be, there is a minus sign, you can see it from the way dl cross V is done. And so, therefore, this is B dot ds by dt, where s is the area, and this is nothing but the rate of change of flux with time. So, therefore, this tells me the way Faraday's law was stated, that the EMF is minus d phi by dt. Now, this is a case which we used the fact that I have a loop which is being stretched. Now, supposing the loop is not getting stretched. But I have just a simple motion. In this picture, what I am showing is that I have a magnetic field which is non-uniform. I have taken the magnetic field along the z direction, but let us suppose that I have a so the magnetic field is outward along the z direction, perpendicular to the screen, and I have a rectangle which is moving with a velocity v along the x direction. And let us say at a particular instant, the left edge of the rectangle is at the position x and the right edge is at the position x plus dx. Now, what I am going to do is this, that let me calculate then how much is the electromotive force. Okay? So, this is done, remember that electromotive force is integral of v cross b dot dl. I am still with what I called as the Mosenal EMF. Only in this case, the velocity is the physical velocity of the loop, which is moving with a velocity v along the x direction. Now, in this case, what I have said is that if you refer to, okay, let me draw this picture here again. So, this is a rectangle, its instantaneous position is x here and an x plus dx there. And supposing I am taking the loop direction like this. So, the magnetic field strength on this edge is B at x. The magnetic field strength here is B at x plus delta x. Now, what I am going to do is to calculate how much is V cross B, velocity is in the x direction. The magnetic field is in the z direction. So, V cross B will be in the y direction, x cross z. So, if it is x cross z, it is minus y direction. So, I have contribution to the integral only from these two sides, because these are parallel to the y direction. So, this EMF can then be written as integral V cross B at point x dotted with, now this dl is, because I am going like this. So, it is minus j, if you like, delta y plus integral v cross b of b at x plus delta x dot, in this case it is along the plus j direction. So, plus j delta y. Now, if delta x is small, I can write b at x plus delta x is equal to, I can use a Taylor series, b at x plus dB by dx, the inhomogeneous field, times delta x. Here, I have got two terms, one is minus, another is plus. And what I will now do is, I will also give explicit form to the direction of V cross B. V is along the x direction, B is along the z direction. So, V cross B's direction is minus y direction. So, this is minus j dot minus j, which is plus 1, but this term will be negative, because this is minus j dot plus j. So, if you now substitute it here, what I am going to get is EMF is equal to integral minus V cross delta B x by delta x multiplied by delta x delta y. you know, V is dx by dt. So, therefore, if I write this as dx by dt, then this gives me dB by dt. So, this will become integral of dB by dt, and delta x delta y is my area. So, this gives me a ds. So, which is again minus d by dt of the flux phi. But you see, in when we do experiments, the charged particles that are there, they do not realize, they experience a force. They do not realize whether this is happening, this effect is happening because that with respect to another observer, the charges happen to be moving, that they are a part of a moving circuit, or just the magnetic field is changing with time. So, whatever be the case, there would be an EMF if there is a change in the magnetic flux. And this change in the magnetic flux can come from either a physical change like stretching of a circuit, actual movement of the circuit, or a changing magnetic field. In the last case, where there is a time dependent magnetic field, I still have Faraday's law valid, but I cannot give you an explanation in terms of Lorentz forces. So, for reasons that we do not understand at this moment, it seems that if there is a changing magnetic flux for whatever reason, that is equivalent to an induced electric field, because I need an induced electric field to define my electromotive force. My electromotive force was integral, loop integral of E dot dl. So, the cause could be physical movement, in which case we give it a special name, we call it motional EMF, or it could be simply a time dependent magnetic field. With this, let us summarize the laws as the Faraday's law as it stands. So, we had seen integral of E dot dl, which is my EMF, is minus d phi by dt. And the flux is by definition integral B dot ds. This line integral I am going to convert using Stokes' theorem to del cross E dot ds. So, this is equal to minus d by dt of B dot ds, and this integral is over arbitrary surface. Since the integral is over the arbitrary surface, well, I can also write this as partial dB by dt dot ds. What I get is del cross of E is equal to minus dB by dt. So, Faraday's law, which tells us, which is the first time varying phenomena that we have introduced, tells us that if there is a changing magnetic flux, this produces an EMF in the circuit. And this is, so in addition to, for example, del dot of E equal to rho by epsilon 0, del dot of B equal to 0, these were the two Gauss's law. I have this equation. Remember, in the absence of time varying field, del cross of E was equal to 0. I am still left with one equation which I have not yet talked about, and that is del cross of B equal to mu 0 j, the Ampere's law. What we will do in the next lecture is to find out if there is time varying electric field, how does Ampere's law change? And once we have done that, we would get a set of four complete Maxwell's equations. And that will be done next time, that is talking about just as time varying magnetic field gave us an equivalent induced electric field, we will see that a time varying electric field can be shown to be equivalent or give rise to an induced magnetic field. As to why that is a rather weak thing or a difficult thing to observe and things like that, this will be the content of our next lecture.